I was stunned, right? This is one of the first time I'm stunned to go to a war show. This is probably 2009, I went to a war show. I'm taking it to MTV or whatever. He like, I see Erykah Badu for the first time. And I'm like, damn, this motherfucker is cold in person. I'm on her. I see her, you know, young LA nigga fucked up mentality. I'm like, I'm finna have her. Like, I'm finna show all
she
these
got the
niggas.
Sexuality.
You, and it's like she just be floating because she don't even be walking because she was just floating past. I was like, oh, I'm finna have her. This, I'm finna do this. This right here is it.
Like, and she like rappers.
Man, feel me? I'm a gangster too. This gonna work out. So I'm looking. I said, Birdman, I'm tapping him. I said, look at her right there. He like, yeah, she called. I was like, yeah, I'm finna go get her. So I get up to try to go shoot my shot. The nigga grabbed me and snatched me down. And mind you, this nigga ain't the type of nigga that really, to me, get too invested in most of the shit. He give you game and all that. If you listening, it's cool. If not, he gonna let you walk. But he grabbed me. He said, hey, man, don't do that. I said, why not? Look, nigga, I'm finna get her. Nigga, you think I can't get her? He said, nah, man, she on some shit. I'm like, man, you tripping. Let me get up. I'm thinking he said, like, I can't get her. He sat me down, he grabbed me, snapped me down. He said, nah, G, man, she like a witch or something. She on some other shit.
People be saying that. People say that. I heard that before.
So I looked at him, right? I'm like, man, you tripping. I look back and I look at his face. And all I thought was this nigga from New Orleans. So I'm like, you know what? Let me just chill because it's the reason he's saying this shit. And I never got out.
Yeah, that Baduism, man. Get that Baduism on you.
I wear shoulder pads.
How many years ago was that? About 7, 5, 7? You be sitting there right now with some dashikis on or something.
That pussy is legendary.
The legend of it is legendary. I ain't really heard nobody speak on it firsthand, but it just...
That would be just a podcast.
Her body working right before you.
Yeah. I was thinking about it, right? Common, like, I remember the videos changed for Common, and then different people, and then Andre, and I'm like, whatever that is, I need to know.
It's definitely some magic in there, man. It's definitely something magical about it. I'm just basing that on the facts.
Sure. Yeah, it's obvious you look at people.
On the facts.
All right, so, conversations... Hold up, no ceilings, GL, my boy Peter, feel me, y'all know how hard on that. When my uncle Short, man, the ultimate player, the player before I even understood what playing was about, feel me, when I just was listening to records, and I was like, man, this nigga is talking some crazy shit. What up, bro?
P.O.P., the player of players. The
player of all players. I like that.
Pop.
There you go.
That's an album.
It really is an album, though.
The player of all players.
I'm trying to tell you, bro.
Pop music.
Come on.
That's a great point.
It really is.
I like that.
Great point.
Anyway, what's up, Aunt Man?
You hear that line in an old Too Short song. It's been said.
The player of all players.
It's been said, man.
Yeah.
Hey, man, the first time they ever got me in the studio and said, you're gonna make an album. What you wanna name that album? I really couldn't. I didn't have no slick ass title on deck, so I just was like, "Shit, name it. Don't Stop Rapping." That was my theme from day one. When you grab the mic, don't stop rapping like fucking 100 bars, whatever. Just go. Fuck the hook. Just don't stop rapping, and then rap a lot, and fucking never stop making songs. Just stop. I've been doing this shit, man.
Living fuck all rap shit. Rap shit is world renowned, and the motherfuckers done ask you about the rap shit forever. And I,
living up to it.
Yeah. The player shit. I get it because I'd have been up top, right? I'd have been in order.
That field of rap. That's what made the rap.
It's just the player shit.
That's what made the rap. I was walking down the street with my radio. I was flowing at the time, you know, doing like little rhymes. Rhymes used to go like, like, I was, like, mimicking what I heard out of New York. So, be like, yeah, the girl in the red, I heard what you said. You know, that it was lame as fuck. But it was, like, it was rhyming, and it was novelty, and people could see you doing it. It was like, he's rhyming. But then I was walking down the street with my radio, and a message came on. First time I ever heard it. And he was like, broken glass everywhere. People pissing on the stairs. No, like, that shit. And it gave me a visual. I was like, that was my first time that a rap song made me see something.
It's crazy. I had a conversation with Eric B. and my other partner from New York, and I told him I could tell when y'all came about, the message meant more to y'all than anything else. Because your shit, Ice-T shit, NWA, Easy Nip shit.
Yeah, open the floodgates to tell your story. It's like, everybody got that light. I got that light. I was like, fuck. I'm sitting there rapping this shit. I'm about to start rapping about Oakland. Like, it was that easy. And shit, and that's the formula right now. That's where the game comes from. It wasn't like I was sitting there at that moment in time in my life going, damn, I got so much game. I need to just start rapping about game. It was really like,
this is how you live.
I was like, oh shit, I'm in it.
Yeah.
I'm in the motherfucking movie called Oakland. I'm in it, and all the game is just all around me. And I'm like, all I gotta do is rap about Oakland, like they rapped about New York. And that's what started it.
That's crazy. Now, Pete is a player. Well, I think he's a player because he got hurt.
No. I'm a retired player. I'm not a player no more.
What's the definition of a player?
I don't know. Depends on, I guess, who you ask and how you ask it. All I know is this, and from what you were saying a second ago, I couldn't buy an ounce of game with cold, hard cash before I moved to Oakland.
You got to learn it.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, he lived uptown.
I lived there. I lived on MacArthur back in the day. And it's like 04, so like right when like Sideshow was going on and all that kind of shit. By the time I left out of there, couldn't tell me shit. I had a reputation within the city. It was great.
You know what? That might be why you hard on a motherfucking woman like that, though. Your time in the bank. Because the thing about the West, the whole West, is they don't play about women. They hard on women. If you think you just something, you better be what you say you is, because the whole West is hard on the women. But I definitely agree. Northern California, it's a different vibe. They ain't gonna play.
It's training, man. It's training. And it's not, it's really, it doesn't have anything to do with how you get at a female. That's not what the training is. People interpret it different ways. So when you receive the game, you got a lot of choices on how you put it back out there.
Mm-hmm.
But it's really about just not being a sucker. Just period, point blank, in all your situations, don't walk into the room and be the sucker. Don't be the weak nigga. Don't be the nigga that's getting used. Don't be exactly. Manipulated. Be the manipulator. So if you're not going to be manipulated, the best way to do it probably is to learn how to be a manipulator. And then it's like being a con man, but you don't necessarily have to run cons on people. But being a con man and learning them, you ain't finna get con. You know all the angles. So it's all about like trying to learn the angles, man. Like, I see how she coming at me. I'm not finna spit the same game every time at a female, but I see how she coming at me, so let me go to file number 101-23 and run that game on her. You know what I'm saying? Or deal with her like that. And it's like, every situation, you're supposed to be, you know, be able to think on the fly. Every situation is a different situation. And player is something that you choose to be. There's a lot of game that motherfuckers that don't want to be a player. They found something good that they wanted like this.
That's like my story.
You know, I feel like a pimp who never had to pimp. So instead of pimping hoes, I decided to just be a player. I'm gonna use my game that way. So a lot of females come into my area and come get close to me and might be thinking they dealing with, like, you know, some square level type shit or some player type shit. And I'm really like mentally like leveling up on her like with pimp game.
Wait a minute, this had to be in the 80s. Ain't nobody couldn't have tried to run no game on you past 90, nigga. Your player was world renowned by that point.
You gotta get slick in the game by, you have to elevate.
So women were still trying you past 91?
Women thought it was an act and they would roll up like thinking, oh, this ain't really what it is.
Well, you know, chicks to this day, I mean, they just kind of like go fishing, man. Like, you know, like.
Man,
like,
hell no.
Men don't live in a universe of no consequences. We know this.
They give you that open door. Do you want to be a sucker? Like, they all the time. Like,
they try to get you to be a sucker. Steve.
Man, I didn't have. Bro, I can tell you a story. We can talk about this shit endlessly. One of my favorite days was, we had the whole little mob with us. We out of town at a All-Star basketball in like Denver or some shit somewhere, and this chick pulled up on me like with a hoe vibe. She getting at me like she want me to be on the pimp vibe. She talking like a real hoe, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And just a couple of little exchanges, and I say, I'm like, I'm in real mode at the moment, right? We hit the All-Star, we kicking it. I'm like, baby, look, I ain't no pimp. I be rapping, you know what I'm saying? I mean, you know, it's all good. I just like, she turned around and told some nigga, she was like, hey, baby, this nigga T-shirt said he don't got no hoes. And then she was like, that's my nigga right there. He's a real pimp. Then she started getting like real, like about to go there. And I rolled up on homie. She was still talking. And I rolled up on homie. I said, man, you might want to make her stop talking, bro. Like, not with a whole bunch of, I'm like, you might, because niggas is going to either beat her up or him up, whatever. It was going to happen.
So, fuck all the raps.
He shut his bitch up.
Who was the coldest player you remember coming up from up top?
It was a lot of real ones.
But it's always that one that got you, and you're like, that nigga's real, this is the.
And then, you know, rumors about shit like before me, like people like the Warner Brothers and shit, that the movie, the Mac, it was in the movie was like partially about them and shit. It's names, bro, legendary names, like, you know, like I used to hang out with these dudes at Keith and Kev, and their daddy was Roosevelt Taylor. And Roosevelt Taylor, he got a shout out in the Mac, you know, they put some real pimps in that movie, like some real Oakland pimps. But in the streets, he was just one of my, you know, a long line of names of real ones. And then he became a preacher. And, I'm sitting here looking at the game, and I know how real it is, but it's like, I don't want to talk down on the man and them, but to me, even in him being a preacher, I still seen the pimp. I seen it. Like, he was still, like, one of my heroes. But when I was coming up, not the legendary dudes before me. It was niggas. I went to high school with Frank the Bank. Frank the Bank came to school every day, dressed like a fucking pimp. Dressed like a pimp. Every day to high school. One of his hoes went to school with him. She came to school.
High school.
They went to high school. Yeah, she came to school.
Oh, okay. A nigga was a pimp in high school with hoes in high school?
And they was going to class. They wasn't even like being on campus being like
pimping at home.
No, he just thought he looked it. If whether he had his hat on or suited with a bunch of jewelry on, whatever, every fucking day. His name was Frank the Bank. Nigga had a perm, fucking perm down to his shoulders.
That's like Kid Ray.
The look, the man, Frank, and everything is like style and shit. Frank would have the bitch that didn't go to school. She probably was an older bitch. She would drop them off at school. So, you know, we out there in the morning hanging out before we go into school, and this nigga get dropped off. There's 2-3 hoes in the car. He jump out with the one little hoe. And they go into school to class. And then after school, probably lunchtime too, the fucking hoe come pick him up in the car, top down.
Gee, like, to me, like, going from down here to up there, like, everything down in L.A. is gang culture. Everybody, if they're not a gangbanger, they're cousin a gangbanger, they're not a gangbanger. It seemed like the same thing, but for pimping in Oakland. Everybody kind of half-ass fancied himself a pimp or a player or an uncle of pimp or whatever else.
Even if you're a gangster, you still like you might feel like having a pimp persona. It's just yeah, embedded in the culture.
It's in there. Have you ever been down like international when it's really lit, when there's a couple hundred women down there? That's insane to me. I never seen anything like that of any city.
Back in the day, it used to be more like San Pablo. There was always a lot of little places where the post-shows and shit, but...
And San Pablo's kind of burnt out.
My favorite one was San Pablo. That was like a fashion show down there. That was big time.
Frank the Bank. You ever heard anything about him?
Frank went out to the Midwest, and you know he survived the game. He's been around.
Frank the Bank.
He kept his chest pulled up all the time. I can show you a picture of Frank. He's on the wall in the building, actually, on the picture.
We gotta
get a picture.
That's fantastic.
On the picture over there with all the pimps.
He needs to be immortalized for such players.
For sure, for sure. And then, you know, we have dudes like Gangsta Brown. Gangsta Brown was one of my immediate heroes because Gangsta Brown used to drive a brown limousine Cadillac. And he was driving it. And in the back, he had rolled the windows down while he come rolling through, and it was just full of hoes. Big 3-4 hoes in the back.
This shit don't even seem real. I gotta watch the Mac.
I ain't lying, but then let me tell you how the shit evolves though, man, because, you know, before us, it was real pimping like the Mac. The Cadillac with all the shit and the fucking clothes and the matching and the, you know what I'm saying? It was that. That's the late 70s, pushed into the early 80s. Then it started kind of I ain't gonna say changed it a lot, but the biggest blow to the pimp image was crack. When the crack hit, you got, you know, the dope dealer get on his own product and go down, he just be like, oh, he smoked out.
Yeah.
But then there's a few pimps that got, you know, the whole little look, you know, when it, let's say you're a clean ass pimp and then you get hooked on crack, nigga, eventually you're gonna ride that car to the, only got three rims. And it's all, you know, it's fucked up. You got a dent, then your clothes get a little shabby. And then somewhere down the line, we started having an image of pimps looking like that.
Yeah.
And we forgot the magic of what these motherfuckers had did for hundreds of years.
If you, like, say late 70s, pre-crack, and the track would pretty much be, I would assume, before my time.
Like a fashion show.
Yeah, but it would be populated by, like, professional hoes who had pimps.
Pretty as fuck?
Yeah.
How's that?
You start getting, I don't want to say 1099 kind of hoes who just strung out, got to go sell some pussy to get a hit real quick, polluting the track. I would imagine when that started happening too.
That's how I grew up.
That's what happened right after 85.
Like, I grew up seeing pimping and hoeing that way. Like, I didn't even see hoes. I only seen strawberries.
So if you got a, certain integrity about what you do, and you see this drug flood the turf, the track and shit, and fucking it's just making the shit look bad. And that whole little, like, I just got the image of when it was like, it's like your dick for $20 and it's just, you know, crackhead hoe, you know, it's just like, but the glamour went out of it. But then it never went away, because you sit there and talk about, like, you say she's a hoe, but she's a call girl. And you like the call girl, you expect her to kind of like carry herself a little different.
So call girl now is the old prostitute.
She could walk into a hotel and walk up to a hotel room, walk, do her deed, walk back out, get in her car to go. As well as she could do be a call girl, go do a house call or something. But you see a hoe as a bitch who get picked up into a car on a street corner for chuck change and do in the car or something, or go do it in a cheap motel or something.
Yeah.
But the other side of it, so you say, what does a call girl make? Oh, every time she go on a call, she gonna make $500 or better. So
that's, so call girls is the old prostitutes, the real ones.
No, that's just, it's just a different level. It's like selling rocks or selling ounces or selling kilos. What level you on? So the fucking the call girl is now, you know, this turns into, from that old crackhead shit, it turns into where you want to be. You don't want to be on the street, you know, bitch, get on here, get my money. You don't want to be that guy no more. That's like fucking little kid games and shit. That's some shit, like the real ones, like, they wasn't even in that world. You sitting there stuck on crackhead hoes and all that. These niggas over here looking like, the nigga might play for a sports team, or the nigga might be a rapper, or you're like, I don't know who this little baller ass motherfucker is, and got three or four, and they knocking down, you know, 15, 20 a month each, and it's coming daily, gobs of cash, and you sitting there making fun of these pimps and not even knowing the whole time the game moved on, and the game kept going, and it was like, it was a beautiful thing, bro. Like, I can take you through eras of, like, East Coast, Miami, fucking here in LA, fucking Vegas like a motherfucker, Hawaii, and the game lives on. Like, that crackhead image stayed in shitty ass neighborhoods, and you know, if that's what you want to go for, but man, that P shit, it ain't about a fucking suit and tie and a motherfucking rhyming and shit with words with your fucking name or some shit. Motherfuckers riding Lambos, bro.
Yeah, yeah. It's unclear to pay a prostitute.
Because
I think I've been on this whole spiel, like, right when I'm working on music. I just think that's unclear.
Yeah, so,
you're not a real player if you're paying.
So, look, if you got an arrangement going with a chick, if y'all got some kind of arrangement where it's a money-making family vibe, money coming to the, like you sit at the table, you bring in money. I mean, if you got a money maker, you don't want her to be broke. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You want to let her live her best life too. If you're living your best life, let her You know, it's different ways. Like, some dudes is like really hardcore on it. But if you're just a civilian and you come in contact with a hoe, I mean, she's only looking at you one way if you give her money. There's no other way. And if you don't give her money, she's only looking at you one way. Like, you're a trick, but you're not a trick. which one are you, shit?
You either pay me or you're wasting my time.
When you're dealing with a real one.
Yeah, yeah.
But now we got the blurred lines of
these all those
cash out hoes.
They don't know what they want to be. They want their $40. $40.
Bitch, meet you at the table in the club and say, if you cash out me $200, I'll suck your dick and spend the night with you.
Yeah, that's some shit. That's some shit.
Bitch, if you don't get away from me. Cash
at
me right now.
That's why I said
you see so much though. Shit that's funny though. Like us talking about cash, like I can't imagine a motherfucking broad that's gonna come up trying to play you.
Bro, but you know that's my life. The trick philosophy is, I mean, I was gonna take her to dinner anyway.
I heard niggas say that. Niggas be killing me with that.
Okay, here we go. That's my food.
Well, like, all right,
that's true.
That's food delivery.
You know, you
delivery guy
look at me at face value.
Yeah.
Girls think this is a walking
a white man.
Easy bread situation. Yeah. Yeah. So I get all of that.
You get all the offers.
I get inboxed cash apps.
Unsolicited.
Like, just
hey, what's
case,
up? I think you're cute. You should holler at me. Here's my cash app. I don't even know you. Like, they walk up to me like that, like it's
do
whatever.
You feel
it's been like
extra
that forever.
Salty about that, or was like, so you really just think I'm just
not really, because I view it as an opportunity. Now you're gonna learn, you know.
I hang out with a couple of white pimps, man. It's like,
what about
it's,
white players?
It's
there's some white pimps.
White, was it white folks from Chicago?
I'm not talking about the suit and tie, the OG. I'm talking about some young,
real white pimps.
Yeah, I mean, it's a way to do it, bro. But look, you know, game is game. They learn real fast. Like, if you live and die by the game, they just learn real fast who you are. Like, they engage in you all. Man, I don't know about this game, goofy hoe and shit, but real hoes, at all times, they just, like, they got the whole sonar on you, man. They be, like, reading, is he or ain't he? Because if you ain't got no money for it, she ain't really putting a whole lot of energy in you, period. It's just a time frame. We should try to figure out you gonna bread me up or not.
But it's
the real game is vicious. It's savage. It ain't for everybody, man. That real life, real game. That play game is what we all been rapping and talking about.
You gotta really know what's for you.
That play game where, you know, the new way, man, like you can call yourself a pimp, you know what I'm saying? You could, you know what I mean? It's call yourself a player and all you're doing is paying all the hoses with you, but you a player. That's the new day.
Can't pay.
And he got the,
that's a,
the sand.
I call that an Atlanta player.
I don't know who said it first. It ain't tricking if you got it.
That's a lie. It's tricking still.
Yeah, it's just tricking.
That's
that.
Cool. That to me, that's
it's I just tricking that ain't culture. Affecting your pockets.
I prefer. That's the one thing I love about Stunner Man, right? That's the one thing I love about Stunner Man, right? With Stunner Man, they knew it was tricking. It wasn't never like trying to. They never denied it, right? It was like, oh, this ain't tricking. This is tricking still.
Like when I talk to girls from Atlanta, and this is a little maybe more socio-political, you know what I mean? Like it's trying to find a diagnose what makes West Coast mentality a West Coast mentality. But girls from Atlanta, like, well, I expect a guy to be a gentleman and to pay for da 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 da. And I'm like, sweetheart, you're in Los Angeles. Like, firstly, so all that Southern gent crap, you can leave it where you came from, because we don't do that shit out here. But to your point, why do you think I should do that? What about you makes you think you deserve that from me? Out the box. Why? Never an answer. But I feel like down in like the Texases of the world, you got extra cash on hand if you're a regular guy because life is cheap out there. Out here, life is not cheap.
So you saying because
if I wanted to go spend money like I wouldn't, like you got an extra $700 a month to go blow on impressing a girl every month in Dallas. If I did that out here in the wrong situation, I'm gonna be evicted over pussy.
Puff, are you online?
Like, nobody getting evicted over some pussy
so
in Houston.
So we just recording this show for you just to broadcast it live. Oh, cut your shit off, please.
Can you please cut it off, Puff, so we have something? That's the thing, man. The hardest part about Flair is watching when somebody try to play. Mm-hmm. That's why I can't commit to being a player. It's just, it's too, like, you got to be on guard all the time. But I can't trick neither. And I don't know. I think that's just because I'm from here.
That's why I say I retired. Because now I look at it like I want to buy my time back.
And all that is makes sense.
That's what it was. Because if I look at it like I'm giving you my time for free, I'm saying to you our time is worth the same amount. If I'm giving you money for my time, I'm saying my time is worth more than yours. Because it's profitable to me to give you money for your time.
So what's affordable for a fine bro that if you wanted to pay?
I don't know. I can't dig into my soul to do it.
They was talking about like the baddest bitches in LA, the baddest bitches, and they start putting up numbers. It's like a barbershop full of ballers. They start putting up numbers. They're like, well, you know, oh girl, such and such. They're like, oh yeah, she fine as fuck. They're like, nigga, her rent like $3,500. You pay the rent, you can fuck for a month. Nigga was like, I got $3,500. That's how the conversation was going. I'm just sitting there listening to my haircut.
Oh my God, I know you had to be so betrayed.
You're like,
you raise this generation, this is what we gonna do.
But a nigga said, man, if she charged $3,500 to be her boyfriend for a month, I'm in.
I just don't think nobody's that bad, I don't think.
I'm saying, bro, it's
is there a woman that I think is that bad to where I would pay for her company? I just can't believe that.
I'm paying for her absence.
It's a trick leisure of not having to go through the brain power of the fucking back and forth with the dialogue and then the ghost.
But that's the best part.
No, it's not the best part.
That is.
I mean,
you want that in the world. We want a lot of that in the world because you know, pussy makes money, and you know, if a chick is like on the independent side, or if she got some sponsorship or something,
either way, it's
going into the universe.
I had a conversation about this earlier. I wanted to tell you about this, fucking kid. No, look, so I was telling the homie on live. I was like, the problem is men try to value themselves based off the pussy they get. Mm-hmm. And like, if you getting pussy, I was talking to Katie, we was bushing, chopping it up, and we was having a conversation about fucking. And he was like, we was talking about Drake specifically. I don't remember what we was talking about. It wasn't nothing crazy, but he was like, man, Drake music ain't for people that get pussy. And I said, that's crazy because everybody get pussy. He like, nah, gee, everybody don't get pussy. I said, it's a nigga in a tent on Maple and Fourth right now getting some pussy. And I noticed that niggas started to value themselves off the bitches they was fucking. Like, the bitch don't got the one lady or the one man that nobody's gonna be proud she did. And I noticed other people wanted girls that I talked to because I talked to them. And I'm like, well, I don't understand how is that valuable if she'll fuck anybody. Like, it's always, any girl who you overvalue, any girl that's overvalued, she to hear somebody that you was looking like, fuck that nigga?
I know, man, but it's a popularity contest going on right now, and it's just a matter of what kind of little clips can you get and what kind of little still photos can you get. So if you go into the frame of a lens and you put on some fake-ass diamonds and some fake-ass gold and you pay a bitch to stand there in a picture with you, or two bitches that you pay, and y'all, and it's a bottle on the table that you bought, and you fucking show that picture to somebody later on, you could redefine that moment. You know what I'm saying? You could just let the moment look at them, captioning something, and that validifies your player.
But the OG homie told me,
you pay for all the shit and shit. You got overcharged for the bottle. You paid the two hoes.
Exactly.
You fucking bought the fake jewelry. Everything about you in that picture is fake. And you put a caption, you know, and then motherfuckers get hella likes. They like it.
Shame. There's no more shame.
Yeah, I'm telling
because
you,
because to me, most of the time of the stuff I don't do, I ain't gonna tell because I don't want to be ashamed of myself. I'm not gonna do certain things because it's shame on myself. These niggas could look in it like these niggas could look in the mirror and be lying and be okay.
But look where the validation is coming from. The validation used to come from only the streets, only the community. Now it comes from imaginary motherfuckers that just got to tap a screen twice. That's validation, two taps. So validation used to be, man, Glasses said you a real one. Now two taps,
If enough people do that, that them tap says you're a real one. And you ain't did nothing to become that. I'm sure that I ain't following it, but I'm sure somebody just became super fly ass gangbanger. I ain't talking about no name.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
From social media, like nigga,
yeah,
I'm hard, nigga.
Yeah, yeah.
And like, man, this nigga ain't nobody in the streets know of his rep.
And to me, like it, what's crazy is I don't have a problem with it if your own homies is validating. That's where I kind of be like, I ain't tripping. If your own homies gonna let you get it off, I ain't tripping. What fuck with me is when they start trying to convince me. And that's my issues. Like I was telling Charlamagne, my issues with trans people in general is don't try to convince me. Convince yourself. That's the only thing I feel like as a man or as a human being, convince the person in the mirror. But when people start trying to mess with your mind, so if certain people like that was putting on the show of being a gangster for their brand, start trying to convince me. That's one thing I never had to deal with.
So what about like the inception of a whole new hood? Like you take New York 25, 30 years ago, and like Atlanta just recently in the last 5 or so years, a little more maybe.
Yeah,
and you know, no matter where it come from, New York, they said it came from the prisons and spread out to the streets.
Atlanta, I feel like it definitely came from hip hop or something. I don't know where
it's could be.
I'm just saying, how you feel about like motherfuckers just wake up one day, they got a bunch of us little homies, we hang in the apartments. We like, fuck it, nigga, we the so-and-so Crips now. And then, for a minute, it's like, bro, y'all ain't even really, but then 10-20 years from now, them same niggas, it's a whole little pack of little niggas that were born into that shit. And you say, man, y'all hood ain't real. They like, nigga, I'm born in this shit, nigga.
That's why I keep saying, I argue with the homie the other day. I'm like, you can't tell a nigga out of town that Crippin' ain't real. Them niggas grew up with Crippin' and Bloodin' at this point.
Yeah.
So it don't matter its origin. You feel me? It don't matter where it started at. If it's 2-3 generations deep, like, it's certain states across the country. Me and Dog had this conversation. I'm like, niggas grew up gangbanging. They older brothers. Some niggas' fathers in other states were gangbangers. So now the kids growing up in it. So at that point, it don't matter where it started at. Nobody give a fuck.
Rap would allow me, if I was looking at this shit all wrong, rap would allow me to be the coldest pimp in the world. Just because what I was rapping about, I could have just said, fuck it. At some point, just went and got 8 hoes and was like, fuck, rapping just been out of control.
Yeah.
And it would have been the life imitating art, not the other way around, you know? Could have did it, bro, like, you know?
Yeah, it was. I'm sure a lot of prostitutes came to you and was like, hey, I will sell for you.
They did a TV special on that. Like, BET did a thing where there was, like, actually at one of your shows backstage, some girl, they were following around. She was trying to be, oh, I'm going to go up on Too Short, and I'm going to go get on his team and shit. Like, she thought this was a real episode of television. And you were on there looking indifferent as fuck about this bitch walking up to you trying to join your team of hoes. And you were like, what are you doing? I'm about to do a show.
She's like, nah, I'm for the seven for the day.
Short hair and shit and shit.
So, that's how I feel about, like, your rap being, like, player. Like, it was always player. Like, I heard pimp, but I think I always got player.
Yep.
So that's, I could never imagine somebody 12 years, you know, in 90 fucking 2 talking about, I'm gonna play Too Short, bro. That just, how could you listen to Too Short and think to yourself, eventually some of this shit got to become real?
As a female, the songs were designed for you to detach yourself from the insults and easily just say, he's talking about her.
You're the only nigga in the world that can get that off, though.
I kind of write it that way a little bit, too.
It had to be something.
It's certain words, like, even in all my raps, I try to make it seem like I'm only talking to one dude. Like, I'm not talking to a group of people. I'm not talking to a crowd. In the rap, I'm always like, yeah, man, I said something. You know what I'm saying? I'm not just like little shit. Just like little shit. It's a conversation to one person. And then every time I go in on that bitch ain't shit type shit, I make sure I don't say bitches ain't shit or y'all bitches ain't shit. It's always like, bitch ain't shit. Why? So if you're a female, you sing along with it too.
That bitch right there. Bitch, you ain't shit.
And I just, I learned that by people's reactions to the songs I was writing. So I just started like writing more like,
that's that.
And the way when I rap to the one person, I call it out. In my mind, I call that one person the Too Short fan. Like, there's one Too Short fan that fuck with Too Short. So, like, real for real.
It was a lady on Instagram with her husband. And her husband, you see that
shit? I seen that, yeah. That's in Sacramento.
Her husband was looking like,
bitch, you know, all the words. Oh, shit. But no, if I think I'm right, I'm doing a song, I'm recording, I'm like, man, that real Too Short fan ain't going to like this shit. Going to be mad. Because I get little information from real Too Short fans. Like, motherfucker, like, man, I like that song, bro, but they didn't have that Too Short bass. So I'm like, when I'm in the studio, I got to remember about that Too Short bass. Or motherfucker, like, man, why you being all nice on that song? So,
you know what's funny? Your brand is as advertised. And sometimes I don't mention you, because I always mention Ice-T. I always mention Dog. But your brand is as advertised. You exactly who you are on the record.
And Banks used to tell me, I record a song, we record some shit. He's like, that shit hard, but you gotta put that Too Short shit on it. So when I figure out what he's talking about, the Too Short shit is go back and say all the same shit, except instead of saying, yeah, bitch, suck my dick, just go back and say, yeah, bitch, suck my dick, bitch. Like say it, and it come out better on the record.
So you didn't really know shit about brand. This just was how you was living.
Exactly. Oh, what branding, marketing, what the fuck is that? I don't know what the fuck that is, man. We was out there being it and really like saying what was really real. So Born to Mac, the album cover.
Yeah.
Nigga, I would never lie about that day. We went up to shoot the album cover. I'm like, this 1987, the day we did this photo shoot. In 87, the first half of 87, I was broke as fuck. Second half of 87, I had hella money. When we shot that album cover, we're right in the middle of them two. That day we go up there, you know, we getting a little paper and shit, but it ain't really happening yet. But my nigga, Ted Bohannon, he got 8 cars, hella money, all kind of shit. You know, him and his brother, they have big gang and shit, whatever. So the Cadillac on Born to Mac album cover is Ted's car. And we go to do the shoot. I'm like, man, we gotta get the caddy, man. We gotta put the top down or something. We gotta go park it up at the top of the town and just see the whole view of the bay and all that. We get up there that day and it's overcast. So we looking at clouds and shit. We don't see the water. We don't see the skyline of San Francisco. We don't see all this shit. So Chris Hicks, CNH, who he put Looney's in the gang. He put Drew Down in the gang. You know, we all the same crew. So Chris, he looking. We up there. It's about, you know, 18 homies, a few cars up there. We got the Cadillac position. We got the photographer. I'm right there. I got probably like got a little chain on or something to do the album cover. Chris was like, we lost. We don't got the scenery. He like, man, fuck all this shit. We as much dope dealers outside, right? He like, everybody, all y'all niggas, take all y'all jewelry off. Put all the jewelry on short. Blah, blah, blah. Like, you know what I'm saying? So we sit up there and over-dramatize everything about it. And when you look back on that cover, you're like, man, that nigga's a pimp. Look at this nigga.
Radio niggas.
But it's Oakland, bro.
You represent Oakland.
It's Oakland. Like, nigga, we all band together to make this motherfucking cold-ass character. And the shit is, you know, so the story I'm trying to tell you is, so now I perpetuate this moment in life. I'm like, money coming in. I'm like, the first thing I got to do that I did wrong in the universe, I gotta go fix that shit. I have to buy this Cadillac, and I gotta go buy a bunch of fucking chains, and I have to drive this Cadillac down the street with these chains on.
I got this shit.
Before somebody say, nigga, that was Ted car, nigga. Nah, nigga, go ask Ted. We go to Pink Slip, nigga. I throw that motherfucker through every hood in the bay.
Just so niggas know it was
with
real.
The top down, it was real life. It was not, Born to Mac album cover was not a picture. It really happened.
For real, for real. All right, look, I ain't gonna keep you, man. I just.
But I'm saying that's the game. You get what I'm saying?
Hard, it ain't. Though. Yeah, though. But
it ain't. Don't mistake the game by saying I gotta get on a bitch. That's not what the game is.
Yeah.
I gotta get all these motherfuckers. Everybody gotta know this shit.
Yeah.
Straight up.
So.
Tell you, bro.
I know you know.
And that's coming from first 14 years of my life in LA. So I gotta go up here and adjust to this shit. I wasn't born into the shit. I got there and just learned the game real fast, like, you know, crash course.
You learn. On top, man, you gonna
tell you something else that's beneficial about Short Dog is them first 14 years gave me something that when I got the Too Short shit together, the Oakland Pimp and all that, I had a fucking ace in the hole that was like way heavy. It was called L.A. You know what I'm saying? And when I go to move around, you gotta go to the big city. But when I go to the big city, it's actually hella familiar, hella family, hella connects. I know the streets. I know I move around. So that.
Where you from down here?
80 from Budlong, man.
Get the fuck out of here.
My cousins everywhere in LA. I got cousins on El Segundo and Main, cross street from Lock High. For life, I got cousins fucking that. My cousins live 105th and Normandy, fucking 84th and Fig, all that 80th shit.
80th and Budlong. We got some property on 80th.
You know my cousins. I got a lot of cousins in LA. But just adding that to it, knowing how to get up and down that Highway 5, and when you get off that freeway, what to do and what not to do, where to go and where not to go, and actually having family and relatives going, oh, you know what this is going on right here, and you know, like really knowing, like I know a lot, like I probably couldn't sit here and talk to you,
but you know,
Crip gangbang history. But I could follow the stories from the fucking 80s when it really jumped up. I can even tell you the shit about before the 80s when I was here. Because I moved away before the gangbang got active.
Yeah, yeah.
It wasn't no motherfucking every nigga in red shooting every nigga in blue. It was like hella territorial. It was a lot of niggas. I lived all Crip shit. So it was a lot of niggas that just was
I
like.
I know exactly what you said.
It was just like Crip, get along kind of Crip.
Yeah.
Like it wasn't Crip on Crip.
Yeah, I never shit. Grew up in that. By the time I came up, it was just where you from versus the niggas next door.
Yeah. And it's crazy because, so I leave on like an elementary school kind of vibe, you know, like kind of young. And when I come back, nigga, everybody I grew up with is banging. I'm like, everybody. And it's like, oh man, my little cousins, I'm like, goddamn. Like,
so you just like a real West Coast California nigga?
Yeah, man. I was fortunate, you know, events that I, you know, occurred in my life and shit, and I just kind of like rolled the wave the right way and kind of.
All right. Before we jet out, how did you not pimp if it's that simple? Well, I'm sure situations could happen, but how did you not commit to the easy opportunity because it had to be? Because,
okay.
You can do it easy without even trying.
I started rapping as soon as I got to the Bay, 1980. Me and my rap partner, Freddie B, we get popular really fast before anybody else. So anybody, period, in hip-hop, we popped it off in the Bay. Then I go to 75 Girls Records with Dean Hodges. I start making records with Dean, and this motherfucking, the shit just blow up. Then from Dean, the next situation, we start our own company, which was with Dean Hodges on 75 Girls Records. He was a D-boy. You know, everybody came up with it. It was all D-boys. So his little brother and his first cousin, we branched off from Dean because, you know, Dean, you know, he, like we the little kids to him. He like, I'm through with y'all. So we branched off and start our own shit using the formula that he used on 75 Girls Records. So we started Dangerous Music. And, nigga, I'd say 87. We started making a lot of money. The first thing we put out was Freaky Tales. Start making a lot of money. I go from there to Jive Records. I start making a lot more money. Start doing tours. I'm on the Straight Up Compton tour with Eazy-E. The next year when Ice Cube quit NWA and went out tour solo, I'm on that tour with him. Nigga, I'm everywhere. Like, so I'm thinking, before I could even think like, man, I'm a pimp, how I love that. I just fall into this Too Short shit. And nigga, I ain't never been stupid. So, this whole time, it's easy as fuck to go, nigga, if you rap about pimping on every album, and then you go out and pimp some hoes, you're actually just doing your own case for the district attorney to just fucking put your ass away forever. That'd be the easiest case ever filed with proving Too Short was a pimp. I couldn't do that shit, man. I couldn't do it. I'm like, it was just, even the weekends and the month and the year and whatever time I did, like, take some hoe money, a hoe would bring, what I said, a bitch on a good month, the bitch go out and bring, you know, average $15,000 a month.
That's a great
deal. Nigga, I'm getting that shit Friday night. Yeah, why am I going to wait on this bitch 30 days and get me what I'm getting Friday? Yeah. Come on, man. All
right, so if it's one last thing, if it's one player, one thing, one person who you feel like throughout your whole career, you done did a million motherfucking interviews and all that, if it's one person you want to thank that you like that that nobody ever says, like, man, you know what? This person was influential in the shit I do, and motherfuckers will have no idea.
I mean, it's only one name you could go to, man, that before anything else that mattered happened, it was the one thing that was a factor was the nigga Dean Hodges. And that was it. Like, I could tell you about what the Bohannons did for me. I could tell you about what, you know, people in the music industry did for me. I could tell you about what family members did. But this nigga Dean was, I've just turned 19. Now, my mama moved from, and my brother, they moved from Oakland to Phoenix. So now, I'm in the town by myself. I done just got up here like 5-6 years ago, and now I'm solo bolo in the town. I get plugged in to Dean through his little brother. Now, Dean is a nigga who's playing kilos and shit. He got this, 1985, he's driving an 85 Benz, he got an 85 Cadillac, he got a house in the hills, he got all this shit. And we would see the nigga ride by, we knew his little brother. You see a nigga ride by, Dean, the kind of nigga, he don't wave at you. You know, some old players, they wave at you. This nigga don't even look your way. He just, like, brand new Benz, straight up the hill. He's a nigga going up the hill. You're like, oh, okay. He wasn't even waving his own goddamn brother.
We see you later.
So, look. So, we really cool with his brother because we know that's Dean's little brother. He got hella, like, benefits, goodies, and shit. And he coming through with the shit. And, you know, he getting his rightful respect for his status in life. So, he like, I'm going to plug you with my brother, man. And he take me up there, and, you know, nigga give us the cold shoulder. Only going to open the door for us, and then he like, hey, what's up, man? You know, come back later. Fucking, we come back later. He roll us up in there. And I ain't never, man. I don't, like, you could talk about this player shit, but this nigga Dean was a player. Like, this nigga had a girlfriend that lived with him. But then at all times, it was just like, bitches. Like, we sit on the couch watching TV. I'm acting like I don't give a fuck, but there's two bitches dancing behind me in their panties. And they, like, just in their own world. And he's just acting like they ain't there. And his house just, he got motherfuckers coming in and out buying fucking dope. He didn't sell nothing under, like, he really sold, like, just, like street famous motherfuckers, celebs and shit. So he had to come by, like, at least buy about an ounce or something. Like, he wasn't no trap house or nothing. And nigga just, he wanted to be a rock star, man. So he was selling a little dope. And he said he had been selling dope since sixth grade. That's all he ever did. He was really good at it. And he was living a rock star life. So he hired all these musicians. He got Too Short the Rapper. He got the bras for the look. He got everything he wanted. And like, all y'all be around me now do it. So we in there, he buying the best studios, the best equipment. Like, when I come out with Board of Mac and all that shit, even before that, when I was doing that City Fire Girl shit, nigga, we on the best shit. Mm-hmm. We got Rick James motherfucking musicians in the house. We got niggas that play with Tower Power. If you got a weakness, he was fucking just like exploiting that shit, man. Like, what's your weakness? Here, take more of it. Keep playing, do that shit. So I learned from the best of the best. I learned in the best studios. At the same time, the nigga put me in this position. He tell me, you know, come stay at my house. I'm standing in his house with all the wild shit going on, with the bitches walking around naked and shit. And I'm just, I'm like player one on one, man.
Yeah.
I don't know who all was in on this shit, but they really reeled me in the game and was like, nigga, you gonna be a real one, nigga. Because the nigga had his broad. He went away one night and the bitch was like walking around with a robe on, butt ass naked and shit. And she was just like, she was like, man, shirt, you know, have you seen you looking at me? I'm like, yeah, you think fine, I'll be looking. And she was like, shit, you wanna fuck? And I'm like, so we had the house by ourselves, right? I'm like, yeah, I wanna fuck. She said, tell me something about Dean. Like, give me some dirt. I said, shit, every time you leave, the bitch next door come over here and they go in the room and kick it. And she was like, I knew it. She was like, all right, I'm gonna give you some pussy. She went in the room, bitch never came back out. The next day, he said, nigga, don't you ever let these bitches do this shit to you, nigga. Nigga, fuck you. Get a nigga out, ride a nigga around. Like, you're like, bro, come on, man.
Don't you ever do that.
Like, we for a bitch like that? Come on,
that was ill, though. You told that, though.
No, but I was
you
saying.
You so young.
But I was saying that
that don't happen, then I'm gonna do it later on again in life somewhere. Yeah. Like nip that shit in the bud, bro. You know. So Dean used to ride a nigga down to L.A. We going down to L.A. I'm pretty sure he was going to make some business moves or whatever. You know, in the street shit. But he on the entertainment shit. We pulling up on niggas like Ice-T and, you know, just chopping up the game. At the same time, he doing the dirt. He doing the legitimate shit, being a label. So the nigga taught me move for move how to get that money in the rap game. Like how to, not rap game, but how to fucking, as a label. Like this is what you got to do. Go do this, go here, go there. And nigga, the shit that he taught me is what I taught all the Bay niggas. Nigga, go to the studio, mix it down, master the shit, go to the distributor, grab that, go take that to the motherfucker, go to the manufacturer, then go to the distributor, go back, make sure your money come back like this, blah, blah, you know what I'm saying? Gave all the niggas that go here shit that Dean showed me. So he's very instrumental to Bay Area hip hop, but you know, even though he wasn't a hip hop person, he was, that nigga wanted to be Jimi Hendrix, he wanted to be Bootsy Collins.
Lonzo.
Yeah. And the nigga literally gave birth to, you know, E-40 and them come from a different legacy. They come from a different, you know, source of where they got the game as far as the music go. But it's the same shit. It's the same independent hustle. And if you got it from knowing what 40 knew coming from St. Charles, or if you got it from Too Short, Ted Bohannon, you know, coming from Dean Hodges, it's the same gang. You know what I'm saying? But you didn't get it from either, or you didn't get it from anywhere else. We invented that shit right up in the Bay.
All right, Brian.
All good.
Brian. It's time to get up. Another sunny day.